Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father, from our living Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. This reading is not a particularly easy one, is it? Do we hear this as law, or do we hear it as gospel? Do we hear these things that admonish us to love your enemy, to give without limit, and to be perfect? I mean, really? Is any of that possible? How shall we understand this reading, this word from the Lord, this sermon that our Lord Jesus gives to us? Well, I would like to consider these verses under the simple theme, on the path to perfection. On the path to perfection. Let us pray. Come into our hearts, come into our hearts. Come into our hearts, Lord Jesus. Come in today, come in to stay. Come into our hearts, Lord Jesus, and may the words of my mouth and the thoughts of each heart be acceptable in your sight. For you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Dr. David Lowe's, president of the seminary, suggests that if we want to really understand this message, this text for today, perhaps the best thing to do is to begin at the end. Now, you already know what the ending is. If we begin beginning at the end to understand what this idea of perfection is all about, and then back up from there. Because you see, the Lord is giving us a teaching here, and teachings are not always easy. I have a quote here that I wanted to share, and I want to do this in honor of all of our teachers here today. A university professor gave his students an opportunity to evaluate his course. I'm looking at Dr. Bill here because, you know, he's a teacher, and he can, I'm sure, relate to this. So the students were given a chance to evaluate his course. And one student said, "I like the course, but I feel very strongly that the professor put too much of the responsibility for learning on the students." Funny, right? But doesn't Jesus do the same thing? In our text for today, does not Jesus, in his preaching, put the responsibility on his students, the disciples? I mean, that's what the word disciple means, mathetes. It means a learner. And the disciples are being taught by the rabbi himself, by the master. And the responsibility seems to be squarely placed on their shoulders until Jesus gives all of these strong words that sound very much like law. I've confessed to some of you that I get the Daily Times, Salisbury Daily Times. And one of the sections that I read pretty faithfully is a couple of the comic strips. And one of my favorites, I shouldn't probably confess all of this, but I will. So one of my favorites is Zits. I don't know why it's called Zits. I have an idea, but anyway. It's basically about a young teenager, and his name happens to be Jeremy. Well, I can relate to that because my son's name is Jeremy. Although neither of them have a whole lot in common, I'm pretty glad to say, but nonetheless. So in this past Wednesday, this one appeared. And the first frame has Jeremy and his father, and Jeremy says to his dad, "Where's mom?" And his father answers, "Not feeling well this morning." And in the second frame, Jeremy begins and he says, "So she won't?" And his father quickly interrupts and says, "Nope." And in the third and final frame, his dad says, "You'll have to nag yourself to school on time." And Jeremy responds, "What if I don't listen?" us today, I certainly don't want to say that he's nagging us. You didn't hear me say that. But he is admonishing us, and he is teaching us. And maybe we too are asking, but what if we don't listen? I.e., but what if we cannot fully obey? And you know, indeed, we can. We can't fully obey. Let's admit that. Straight up. Oh, I almost forgot the choir's behind me. I have to turn around and speak to the choir occasionally, but they're back there listening as well, I am sure. So Jesus says things like this. He says, you have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Now in the Old Testament, that's known as the lex talionis. It's the law of retaliation. The law of retaliation. And its purpose really is to limit the amount of just or fair retaliation. If someone comes and steals a few apples from your tree, it doesn't give you the right to go and burn down his whole orchard or his house or even worse. Okay, so it's to limit, you know. Mahatma Gandhi's response to this was, he said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth only ends up making the whole world blind. You know the story of the Hatfields and the McCoys, right? Two families. I don't remember what started the feud. Maybe some of you do. I haven't reviewed it lately. But the feud went on and on, I guess, for generations, right? At some point, someone has to intervene. Someone has to call a halt. Someone has to declare peace. Someone has to respond to a different law. The law, or at least the way, of love. Now, at the end of this text, Jesus says this, be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. The word perfect that is used in this text, or here's your Greek word for the day. Are you ready? The Greek word in this text that is translated perfect is the word teleios. You can say that with me. You ready? Teleios. T-E-L-E-I-O-S. Teleios. What does that mean? Well, it's not easily translated into English, but it comes from a cognate word, telos. That's an even easier word. It's only five letters. T-E-L-O-S. Telos. Telos is a word that refers to a goal, the end result, the objective, as it were. A few years ago, I planted some pear trees. Planted four pear trees. And 2 years ago, I think it was, my pear trees my sister-in-law was visiting. She went and she counted, I think, 75 pears on my pear trees. I thought that was pretty cool. Now you see, this last year, kind of a bit of a lost year for my family, and I didn't cut my pear trees, and I found out that, which I knew, and I had done this the year before, I got a pretty good harvest. Last year, I didn't have a chance to trim my pear. So this spring, a few weeks ago, I trimmed my pear trees. I've got these 6-foot branches, you know, I cut off. But I'm hoping now that this year, my pear trees will do what they are supposed to do. And if they do, they will be telos. You see, they will be the telos of a pear tree is to what? Oh, you're good. The telos of a, you see, you didn't think you knew Greek. The telos of a pear tree is to produce pears. Okay? So when Jesus says, be teleios, it's translated perfect, he's saying, be mature. Eugene Peterson in his The Message translates this as grow up. Grow up. Be mature. Do or fulfill your purpose. Fulfill or do or complete what God intends for you to do. What is that? What is it that God intends for us to do. So, what is our telos, our goal? Well, Jesus is pretty specific about this, and he lists all of these things, but we could capture this and condense it into one thing, and that's another four-letter word, and you know the word, it's love. Jesus calls us to be impartial in our love and in our living love to others. Jesus is impartial. He says the rain falls on the just and on the... You see, it's not just the good guys that get the blessing, is it? God's love is for everyone. And so we've been emphasizing that here at St. Peter's for quite some time now, and we should always emphasize that as the children of God, because that's the message of Jesus Christ. God so loved the world, and that means everyone. So in order for us to be teleios, to be perfect, we need to be supreme lovers of all people, treating everyone equally and treating everyone in love. Now, Martin Luther said that the Christian life is not about arriving, but always about becoming. And so we are on the way. The hodos, well, that's another Greek word, it means the way. We are people of the hodos, of the way. And we are on this path to perfection. Let us travel forth to the glory of God, knowing that we have been graced by God's love and forgiveness, that we have been empowered by the Holy Spirit to carry forth the message of love in our words and deeds. May God bless us on our path to perfection. Amen. Amen. Now may the peace of God that passes all understanding keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, the way. Amen.